So, all right, welcome everybody. My name is Samuel Horvath, and this is 57th Flow Talk. For those of you who are attending first time, Flow stands for Federated Learning One World Seminar, and was created to provide the global online forum for the dissemination of the latest scientific research results in all aspects of federated learning. Today, it's my great pleasure to introduce you our speaker, Eduard Gorbunov. So Eduard is a PhD student at Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology, working under supervision of Alexander Gasnikov and Peter Ikhtari. And his research interests include stochastic optimization and its application to machine learning, distributed optimization, derivative-free optimization, and variational inequalities. And today he's gonna tell us about his recent work on secure distributed training at scale. Thank you, Eduard. Stage is yours.
Thanks, Samuel, for the introduction. And it's my pleasure to give a talk at Federated Learning One World Seminar, the third time. And today I will talk about a recent paper with my colleagues from Yandex, Alexander Borzanov, Mikhail Niskin, and Max Rubin. The title of the talk is Secure Distributed Training at Scale. So probably an alternative title would be Decentralized Byzantine Tolerant Distributed Optimization. So, and here are my co-authors, Alexander Borzanov, Mikhail Niskin, and Max Rubin from Yandex Research. And let us move on to the content. So I will start with briefly motivating the problem setup, namely Byzantine tolerant optimization problems. After that, I will talk about approaches based on the usage of central server. And after that, we move to the next part, to the approaches that do not use central server. And I will describe our contributions. By the way, if you have any questions, do not hesitate just to stop me after the end of the slide, and I will respond. Okay, so about the motivation. So there are some, for example, very simple problems like classification tasks on MNIST with a very simple model. And these problems obviously can be solved in just a little time, several minutes on just an ordinary laptop. But nowadays, more complicated problems become popular. For example, sometimes people need to use a lot of data, a lot of text data, and to train large models like that have billions of parameters. And these problems, unfortunately, cannot be solved in a reasonable time, even on the top of the line GPU server. And this motivates researchers to use distributed algorithms to train such models and to design new efficient methods. So typically, these problems, one needs to solve the following optimization problem. For simplicity, let us start with parameter server approach. So here we want to minimize function f. Here f of x and x are parameters of the model. G is number of parameters, and f of x is an average of n functions, where n is number of clients, workers, devices, and so I will call it differently throughout the talk, but it will denote the same stuff. Okay, and these workers, they have their own local loss functions and fi's, and these loss functions, they are in general accessible only by worker I. So they are stored privately. And for example, they can have the following form expectation, like here di denotes distribution or some data distribution on the i's client, and fi is an expectation, has an expectation form. Okay, and to provide more motivation, let us consider a so-called collaborative training. Originally, it became popular in natural sciences, where people, different groups of researchers, universities, or even small companies want to solve, for example, some very hard problem, but they cannot solve it on their own because in reasonable time, and they collaborate in order to solve this problem faster. And they just donate their compute power, and in this way they solve hard problems in a reasonable time. But similar techniques were proposed, can be used obviously for training machine learning models, like very complicated models. And these applications are usually called collaborative training. So these guys can be very different, and they do not necessarily know each other. Okay, so consider parallel SGE in the ideal case. So at each iteration, server broadcasts parameters xk to the workers, then they compute stochastic gradients, namely vectors g1k, g2k, and so on. And these vectors usually satisfy some properties. For example, they should be unbiased. It is usually assumed that they are unbiased, and they are constructed in this way. And these stochastic gradients, after they are computed, they are sent to the server, and the server updates parameters. So it is a very simple algorithm, and one can use different variations of this algorithm, but to illustrate the issue, it is enough to consider parallel SGD. So the issue is that here we assume that all workers are good. They compute stochastic gradients properly and do not deviate from the algorithm. But in the realistic scenarios, like in collaborative training, it might be the case that some of the workers are bad, or they are usually called Byzantines. And they can actually compute, or they can actually send something else instead of stochastic gradients. For example, in this case, the third worker is Byzantine, and this worker computes, just not necessarily computes, it sends a vector g3k, which can be arbitrarily bad. And it means that this vector spoils the whole average of this individual vectors, gik's. And that is why a parallel SGD can be broken. So even one Byzantine pair can broke the convergence. For example, it can send some vector with very large norm along the random direction, like not pointing to the solution.
Sorry, Eduard, there's a question from Konstantin, so I'll try to unmute him and he can ask.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Eduard, hello. Can you describe what the Byzantine stands for? So is it any party that doesn't follow protocol? Mm-hmm. And also about this adversary G3K, is it lie in some, is it bounded, or it's unbounded vector? It's arbitrarily vector. Can you describe this?
Yeah. Hello, Konstantin. Thank you for the question. Yeah, this is very important to define who are Byzantines. And in this talk, we assume that Byzantines, they just can send. So they know, for example, they can know everything about computations of individual workers, and they can send arbitrary vectors of the same dimension of that other workers send. So
there is no So there, Edward. So there is no bound. So
yeah,
it's
almost
just
no.
Any
almost
vector from RD.
Yeah, almost no restrictions here. Yeah, any vector from RD, and it can be computed with knowledge of other vectors. So they can actually spoil the convergence significantly. Even one iteration can move us very far from the solution. Okay. Thanks for the question. And as I say, even one bad peer can break the entire training if it's done, if the training is done in the naive way. And this motivates us and other researchers to consider Byzantine tolerant optimization methods. And we start with approaches that use central server. And let me formalize the problem once again and refine the formalism. So we still want to minimize this function, but it becomes it is easy to see that this problem is impossible to solve when local functions are arbitrary heterogeneous. The reason is that when we have arbitrary heterogeneous functions, we cannot distinguish a bad worker from the good one. Because a bad worker can say, oh, I just have a very special distribution, and that is why my local loss function has such strange gradients. And in general, we cannot check it, because if data is private, we cannot do anything with this. Moreover, even under bounded heterogeneity of local loss functions, for example, when when deviation of the gradient from the of the local functions to the gradient of the average is bounded, even in this case, it is impossible to solve this problem with any predefined accuracy. And it is shown in the recent work by Karimi Reddy et al. But the authors also show that overparametrization can help to some extent to circumvent this issue. But still, in more general setup, there is an issue that we cannot solve the problem when we have Byzantines and heterogeneity. Therefore, let us consider the setup when all functions are the same. So it corresponds to the situation when all workers have an access to the full data set and can sample stochastic gradients from the full data set. And let us formalize the notion of good peers and bad peers. So we assume that the number of the set of workers can be split in two groups. Good peers and bad peers, G and B. And these groups are, let's say, static throughout the training. So G, if the worker was good, so it does not deviate from the protocol at any stage. But Byzantine peers, then either they can deviate from the protocol, from the algorithm, or not. And so in this sense, there is a certain separation between them. And we assume that there are B Byzantines, and it is delta, they form delta fraction of all peers. And it is natural to assume that delta is smaller than 1/2. Because if we have more than 1/2, or at least 1/2 Byzantines, it becomes impossible to distinguish between good peers and bad peers, because bad peers can say that they are good because they form the majority. Yeah, but so this is reasonable. And at iteration K, workers send the following vectors to the server, and good peers send stochastic gradients, and namely, it's unbiased estimates with uniformly bounded variance. So we will assume throughout the talk that stochastic gradient satisfies this property. And Byzantines can send anything. And this anything can depend on other GIKs. So this is a setup. If you have any questions, do not hesitate to stop me and ask.
Sorry, Edward, I would have one. So here, do you assume that those Byzantines, that they can communicate and they can, for instance, like pre-agree on what they're going to send, or everybody is independent?
They can pre-agree, yeah. Very good question. They can actually collaborate among them. For example, they can send in a common direction, they can send some very large vector and shift the mean of the gradient, shift the average of the vectors in this case. So they, yeah, and they can actually be more powerful in terms of computation than good peers.
And maybe one other question, just out of curiosity. So if you have the proportion of bison, if they couldn't communicate, so everybody would be independent, can you still show like something, even if number of Byzantines is more than a half? Or it's kind of, it still applies that it should be, at least half should be good peers?
Well, yeah, this is a good question. Actually, I think one can show, or one can prove something under additional assumption that server, let's say, checks some computations, or I don't know, or maybe if server can check a lot of computations at each step, for example, take subset of workers and check their computations, then and do something with this knowledge, then I think one can circumvent this issue when delta is larger than one half. But right now I don't remember the works where people consider these cases. And actually, in this formalism, one can prove that it is impossible to construct Byzantine tolerant method when delta is larger than one half. So we will need some additional assumptions, yeah. For example, as you said, or even more.
Thank you.
Thanks for the question. Okay, then I will continue. Probably other questions will appear during the talk. Okay, how to solve this problem? Very naive approach says that, for example, good workers can solve the problem independently, but it is too slow. And we started, I started this talk from consideration of a particular example when the problem cannot be solved by one peer. And it is necessary to to collaborate to solve the problem. Another alternative, use parallel SGD. But it is not robust, as we already understood, because the main reason is that this guy, one of the reasons, not the main one, but one of the reasons is that this guy, average, is not a robust mean estimator. So it is too sensitive to outliers, let's say. And from the statistics, we know that there are some other rules, other aggregators, like geometric median and others. And it is natural to substitute this guy by some robust aggregation rule. And it sounds good. Let us check what is known about that. And first of all, let us list some popular aggregation rules. First of all, the first one is geometric median. I already mentioned this. Mathematically, it means that we want to solve this problem, find G such that sum of distances to these vectors is minimized. And note that here we do not have squared, so the norm is not squared. And it is the main difference between the average and geometric median. And if you have squared here, you will obtain just average. But here we do not have squares, and then obtain this estimator. To compute geometric median, one needs to solve this problem, and it actually requires some extra work, extra computations. So it's not L-smooth, and therefore it becomes harder to solve. Next, if we change the norm from L2 norm, Euclidean norm, to L1 norm, sum of absolute values, then we will obtain coordinate wise median, because here this problem can be separated into D problems along each direction. And this can be computed efficiently in each coordinate, along each coordinate, we can compute coordinate wise median using O of one, O of N steps. And then we need just to solve this problem along each coordinate. So it actually also requires some computations, but can be implemented faster than this. Next, there exists also so-called Cram estimator. It is computed in the following way. So first of all, for each worker, we identify n minus b minus 2 closest vectors to this worker, and then we compute this sum. So sum square distances to this worker from the closest n minus b minus 2 clients. And we take the SGK head, GK head, we take the worker with the best score. So actually Cram estimator is always sum of these guys. Cram estimator is always one of these guys, yes. In this sense. Okay, so and how this method converges with these estimators? How does it converge? And the answer is it can converge badly, because it can converge even worse than parallel SGD without any defense. And it was shown in this paper. Very interesting paper where the authors proposed special attacks that break the convergence of some of many popular robust aggregators. And you can see from this plot that even parallel SGD without any defense works better than Cram, TrimNim, Boolean. It's another robust aggregator. And so on. So in this sense, parallel SGD is more robust than so-called robust methods. And recently, this issue was properly addressed in this paper, also by the same authors, Karim Ireidi, and Yagi. The paper is called Learning from History for Byzantine Robust Optimization. And I highly recommend this paper to read, because from my opinion, it provides very good formalism and also good contribution to the field. And in mathematics, it's always very important to introduce good definitions, and I think it is one of the main contributions. Not only one contribution, but I like this definition. So they formalized robust aggregation. So they say that GK hat is robust aggregator when the following inequality is satisfied. Here, GK overline is average over the good peers. So it is actually what we ideally want to compute. We want to exclude all Byzantines and have this vector, ideally, based on this estimates. And but according to this definition, it is enough to have this such estimate that the in expectation the square distance is bounded by delta fraction of Byzantines times sigma squared. Sigma squared is it can be variance of the stochastic gradients or pairwise variance, so it's up to the numerical constants are the same. And C is some numerical constant. And it turns out, it was shown in this paper, that all these medians and CRAM are not robust according to this definition. So, and for example, one can consider very simple case when all peers are good and we have an odd number of peers. And each GIK is calculated as it is one with probability 1/2 and minus one otherwise. So it's a very simple example. We just have one and or minus one with equal probabilities. And in each situation, CRAM estimator and coordinate wise median, geometric median, they will return either plus one or minus one for each set of GIKs. However, if n grows, this guy, GK overline, it goes to zero. So for example, the square, the second moment goes to zero as one over n. And it means that it means that this inequality will not be satisfied. Because delta here is zero, but they do not find exact, they even are not close to zero. Okay, and also in the same paper, the authors proved lower bounds for the robustness. And they showed that for any robust aggregation rule, there exists a set of vectors, G1k and so on, gnk, such that delta fraction of them correspond to Byzantine peers and the following lower bound holds. So actually, in general, one cannot hope for better estimator than the estimator defined in their definition. So in this sense, their definition is tight because up to some constant, it achieves the lower bound, the best possible robust aggregator that we can have in the presence of Byzantine peers. Okay, are there any questions about the formalism?
I would have just one quick clarification question. So do you, in this scenario, do you assume that you know the ratio or you don't need to know it?
Yes, here it's, in this definition, it is assumed that, so in the definition, we do not assume that we know the ratio, but when we will construct a robust aggregator, it will be crucial to know this. So in this definition, we just know that it is bounded in this way. And yeah, so we just know this condition. Actually, this can be removed.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for the question. And also one might ask a question, and are there any robust aggregator that satisfies this definition? Because we see that many previous well-known aggregators do not satisfy this. And then it is needed to provide any example of such aggregator. And they also provide, the authors also provide such an example called centered clip. And so centered clip is actually an iterative procedure. It computes, it updates the estimate VL iteratively. And probably I just need to show this picture. Okay. What is going on? VL corresponds to the center of the ball of radius tau L. And these points, red, green, and yellow, they correspond to GIKs. So here, let's say G1 and G2, they are inside the ball. So the distance to the center, to V, is smaller than tau, then we will have just in this minimum, we will have one in, as an answer. And this point is, the distance from this point to the center is larger than tau, and we projected to the surface of the ball. We projected just on the ball, yeah. And after that, we compute an average of these three points. Roughly speaking, centered clip is the iterative procedure where we update the center of the ball. And at each iteration, we project the points on this ball. And after that, take an average of the results and iteratively update centers. And this is an equivalent formulation. And for the theory, it is needed to choose tau L in this way. Do not put a lot of attention to this. I will just say that here it is needed to know sigma, and it is needed to know delta, or upper bound for delta.
Okay. There is one question from Konstantin.
Mm-hmm.
Konstantin, can you? Thank you. So, Eduard, can you repeat one more time? So, for averaging, we include points which are out of the ball after projection, or we completely discard points which are out of the ball?
Thanks. Thanks, Konstantin, for the question. We do not discard these points. We project them, and then we use them in the average. So, like in this formula, when GIK, when the distance from GIK to VL is larger than tau, we take it just with smaller weight. Okay. And the weight is defined in this way, actually. And
actually, this schema is looks similar to RANSAC or random sample consensus, which from classical computer vision community, maybe it's have been created not by people from computer vision, but the idea of RANSAC is also like sample points and create some slab during Pitten linear model, and points which are out of the slab, they can be arbitrarily bad, and the RANSAC schema, I mean, it has some tunable parameters, but it's robust even up to 50% of complete outliers.
Mm.
Maybe, so there is some connection, and I mean, maybe yeah. People, by the way, did you check this RANSAC schemas?
No, thank you for pointing out this scheme. We actually didn't check this, but I think it might be useful as well. Probably, actually, one can construct different aggregation rules. Yeah, and finding a good aggregation rule is, I think, an additional problem and very interesting problem. I mean, good aggregation, good robust aggregation rule means that we can compute it fast. In a fast way, computed efficiently.
Okay.
Okay, thank you for the reference. I will check it after the talk, because right now I don't have an answer how does it relate it, but I will check. Thanks. Okay, so it is center clip, and the authors proved that if fraction of Byzantines is smaller than 1/10, then after L iterations, the following guarantee holds. So we have linear decaying term, exponentially decaying term, and some constant term. And it means that if L is sufficiently large, so after a logarithmic number of iterations of center clip, we can achieve the following guarantee. So we can achieve, we can find a robust aggregator in the definition provided in this paper. And this is good, because right now it seems that we can plug it in the update rule instead of average, and the following question arises: do we need something else? Is it everything we need to have robust Byzantine robust optimization method? And unfortunately, the answer is no. And it turns out that as the authors of this paper show, it turns out that any permutation invariant algorithm is not robust, is not Byzantine tolerant. So what is permutation invariant algorithm? It means that xk plus one, as a function of all past gradients, so past gradients for the first worker, for the second, and so on, the nth worker, it does not change if we arbitrarily permute at each iteration the stochastic gradients. So it means that, roughly speaking, it means that the update rule is independent from the history. So it just uses set of vectors obtained at this iteration, at the current iteration, and then it somehow updates parameters. For example, all such schemes, they are permutation invariant, obviously, because this center clip, it does not depend on the order of these guys, and it does not depend on the previous guys. It just depends on these vectors. And it turns out that for any permutation invariant algorithm, there exists a strongly convex problem such that the following lower bound holds. And here we cannot achieve any predefined accuracy. And if mu strong convexity parameter is small, as it typically is, this quantity can be very large. And to circumvent this issue, the authors proposed so-called client momentum, robust client momentum. And it means that good workers just, they compute this momentum vectors. It's a heavy ball-like momentum. And after that, the server uses center clip. It applies center clip not to the stochastic gradients, but to the client momentums. And now this method is no longer permutation invariant. And that is why the authors managed to prove the following guarantee. So they proved that if the objective function is L smooth and lower bounded, then the method finds an epsilon stationary point after the following number of communication rounds. So it's non-convex setup, non-convex smooth setup. And actually this, the first two terms, they correspond to the complexity of parallel SGD in the ideal case. So it is a very good property, because when delta is zero, the method recovers the complexity of parallel SGD. which is a good property. But when delta is larger than zero, there is a price for Byzantine pairs, and the price is this term, because delta, when delta is larger than zero, it is at least 1/n. When we have at least one bad pair, delta, which is a fraction, is at least 1/n. So for positive delta, this term dominates this one. Okay. But the key limitation in this approach is that parameter server is required. And this means, unfortunately, that approach is not scalable. And therefore, we move to the final part of the presentation. I probably need to accelerate my talk. So Byzantine tolerant optimization without central server. And I will present our method called VTART SGD. Let me briefly remind possible communication protocols. So we already considered parameter server architecture. It is not scalable because when number of for a large number of participants, the communication becomes a major bottleneck, and method the performance does not scale. One possible alternative is to use all reduce procedure. It's special protocols for computing average, sums, and others characteristics. And I will describe in particular this butterfly all reduce on the next slides. Just for now, I will tell you that this approach is scalable, and it's actually widely used, but it is not robust to faults. So if some worker, for example, faults to compute average, it breaks the entire procedure. I will describe the procedure on the next slide. It's just right now I want to mention it. And also one can use gossip-like procedures when we have some communication graph, and workers communicate only with neighbors and compute compute the average using this iterative procedure. So MIJ here is element of mixing matrix that defines the communication pattern. So this approach is scalable, but it has inevitable dependence on the mixing matrix and graph structure. So actually, I will not talk about these approaches in the rest of my talk, but I just wanted to mention it. So right now, we assume that server is not available, and we need to decide what to do. And before that, it is good to understand what is known in the literature. So there exist full gradient approaches and also gossip SGD like method, full gradient approaches, they are not applicable to this particular problem that we are interested in. Gossip SGD like methods, what is known in this paper, in theory, the authors show the convergence, but the result is not better than for one node SGD. So unfortunately, current approaches, they cannot be applied to collaboratively train large neural networks. And therefore, scalable server-free approach is missing in the literature, at least in terms of the theory, because in practice, this algorithm may work good, may work well, but in theory, it doesn't. Okay, so the first idea is very straightforward. Let us just combine all reduced with center clip. And here, let me briefly explain what is butterfly O-reduce. So here, each device splits its own vector in three parts. And worker I becomes responsible for the part I of the vector. So for example, the first worker is responsible for the first parts, for averaging of the first parts. The second is responsible for the averaging of the second parts, and so on. It means that first of all workers, they just send the first parts to the first worker. So the first worker has A1. The second worker sends A2 here, and the third one sends A3 here. After that, this worker average the received parts of the vectors and obtain this A average. And after that, it broadcasts the result to other workers. And in the same way, average for each part is computed. After that, if the protocol is executed correctly, then we will obtain the exact average at each device. And the communication cost of this procedure is O of one in terms of number of sending of sent vectors, because here we just need to send one over n part to n minus one clients and receive one over n part from n minus one clients. In total, it means that we send and receive no more than two vectors. Amount of data equals to no more than two vectors. And naive idea is to replace average by a center clip. But it is not enough, unfortunately, because Byzantine peer, they can do whatever they want, maybe something malicious, instead of computing center clip. So it means that, and we actually cannot check this, because the first parts of vectors are known only to this guy. Because, for example, this guy doesn't know A1 and doesn't know A3. So this guy cannot verify the computation. And it means that we need to add some additional checks for computations. And how to do this? Okay, let us assume that all workers are supposed to compute stochastic gradient using special seeds. And these seeds we can make them publicly available. We can, for example, generate the sequence of seeds, and they will be known before the training. And it means that we can, for example, randomly pick the worker and check whether the worker computes stochastic gradient properly. And this leads us to possibility of verification of computations, and actually using the tools from cryptography, like joint pseudorandom number generators, we can pick random workers such that we can pick workers randomly, such that workers do not know in prior whether they will be checked or not. So it is important because Byzantine peers, they should not know whether they will be checked or not after the iteration. Okay, this is important part. And for example, here, GIK is split in n parts. And let me describe an issue. The issue is the same, only worker I knows all I parts of vectors. So here is a question. Question by Konstantin Mishenko. How does the knowledge of checking help Byzantine workers? Okay, so imagine the situation if Byzantine peer knows that after this iteration, it will be checked. Its computation will be checked. Then this worker will just compute stochastic gradient properly. And if Byzantine peers know a priori whether they will be checked or not, then we cannot verify, we cannot catch them. Have I answered the question?
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks for the question. But here is an issue that Byzantine peers can deviate from the protocol because, for example, in aggregation of, for example, the first peer, if it's Byzantine, it can deviate from the protocol along the first part of the vector. And if you have, for example, two, the issue appears even if you have one Byzantine peer. So it's just typo in slides. So actually here it's this does not save us from malicious behavior of Byzantine peer, because it can compute something else and as an aggregation, and nobody can check this, because only this worker knows all first parts of all vectors. Next, how to resolve this issue? One idea is to use hashes of the gradients, of the parts of the gradients. So hash function, it's actually it's tool from, let's say, computer science. Hash function can be computed easily, but it has the following property that it is hard to compute pre-image. It is hard to find such J, such that hash of J equals the desired output. So actually, let's say we assume that it is impossible to broadcast hash incorrect, to guess the vector that has the right hash. So, and for example, if the worker is checked after the computation, then we can just compute stochastic gradient, check the hash, and if it is not equal to the submitted one, then we just can ban this Byzantine peer. But the issue is that when we have two peers, then they can collaborate. And for example, this peer will say that this is true hash, and this peer also will say that this guy sends right hash. So they can cover each other in some sense. And to prevent this, we need to go deeper into the center-clip equation. We need to go deeper into center-clip procedure. And so actually this algorithm, center-clip, converged to the solution of the following equation. And the idea is to somehow check this equation. But the problem is that only worker J knows all necessary information, namely all J's parts of each vector, and only worker J is able to check this equation. However, we can check this equation along random direction, and this can be implemented. How to do this? The idea is to sample random direction after the workers send these aggregated vectors, and ask other peers to send just inner products and norms. So it requires additional communication, of course, but we just need to send scalars. It's not d-dimensional vectors where d is a billion. It is just one scalar per client. So it's actually very marginal communication overhead. And using joint pseudorandom generator, we can ensure that Byzantines do not know a priori in which direction we will check them. So they, since they do not know this direction a priori, they cannot construct this GJK head in such a way that this equation holds, but it is not the answer of center clip. But there is another issue, because Byzantine peers, they can, so for example here, it is okay because at first glance, it is okay because if we check the Byzantine peer that deviates from this, that sends incorrect norms or inner products, we can easily identify by knowing the seed of the vector. And so Byzantine peer cannot pass this verification, but they can jointly collaborate in order to pass the verification for some Byzantine peer, for one at least. And how to do that? They can send incorrect inner products and norms in order to have this. And unfortunately, even one attack of this type can break the entire training. And therefore, we add another verification. We add we enforce the bias to be bounded, meaning that this deviation, each good peer computes this norm for along each direction, along each component, and along each block of components. And if it is larger than delta max for the majority, then they ask for checking the computations. And yeah, and if stochastic gradients have not very heavy tail distributions of noise, then it is okay to have such verification. And but the impact of this, the influence on this verification is that we bound the impact of the attack during one iteration. So overall, let us put all ideas together. First of all, we have central clip. It is just robust aggregation for good peers. It is the first building block. Next, we introduced hashes, norms, and inner products. These guys are needed to guarantee that all violations can be revealed either on the fly or during the check of computations, which goes after the update, after each update. Next, we bound the bias. It is needed to bound the power of each Byzantine attack. And after each update, we randomly pick workers to check their computations. And it is needed to identify and ban Byzantines. So overall, it results in Byzantine tolerance all reduced or BTARD. And I already explained everything. Let me just briefly formulate the algorithm. So good workers, they compute stochastic gradients, then they compute hashes, exchange them, and after that they check, for example, worker I, it can check hashes for the ith parse. And if hash is inconsistent, then worker I can accuse worker J. And we use here the famous Hammurabi rule. So if worker I accuses worker J, both should be banned after that. So at first glance, it sounds weird because we can ban a good peer. And for example, bad peer can accuse good one. But very this procedure has a very good property. At least one Byzantine peer will be banned at any case, in any case. So if I is Byzantine and accuses good peer, then it will be banned. Or if good peer accuses Byzantine, it will be banned. And since good workers form a majority, and if we assume that the fraction of Byzantines is not too large, then it will be enough. We can eliminate all Byzantines. If we eliminate this way all Byzantines, then we will still have large number of peers. So in some sense, it is weird, but it is working. It can be used. After that, they compute central clipped, as I said, instead of averaging received the results, compute random directions to check central clipped equation, compute this inner product and norms. And after that, there are additional verifications in order to check that norms are consistent. And the worker I can check it for the ice parts. And if something is wrong, it can accuse. So similarly for inner products and for and after that, other workers, they check this equation. And if something is wrong, then they accuse worker J because it sends incorrectly the aggregation. And worker J, in this case, if worker J is good and this doesn't hold, this worker should accuse the corresponding ones either in this step or in this. So good workers are protected here in these attacks. After that, finally, they check that deviation is not too significant. And if it's significant, they check aggregations. So, and BTARD SGD, it is just parallel SGD, but instead of averaging, we use our procedure called BTARD. And here we have active peers at iteration K and compute only for them, BTARD procedure. And after that, randomly pick two M workers, M of them check other M ones. Okay, so in the paper, we prove that all possible violations are detected either instantly or when they are checked after the update step, for example, or they are checked here. Next, as the result, all Byzantines peers, they can violate the protocol only during a finite number of steps because in expectation, because this positive probability 1 over m, larger than 1 over m, they are checked. And therefore, on average, they cannot deviate from the protocol more than m iterations. Therefore, impact of one, and moreover, our procedure has the following property that the impact of one violation is upper bounded. And this helps us to prove the following guarantee. Under uniformly bounded variance and quadratically bounded tails, let me just skip it for now because it just says that the tails, the noise in the stochastic gradients is not too heavy. So it's like, it's not very strong assumption, for example, for computer vision applications, but for natural language, for NLP problems, it's it can be complicated to achieve, but we have another method for this. I will talk about this at the end of the talk. And in the non-convex case, we prove the following complexity bound. And also we derived another bound that that is better if, and we derive if it under additional assumptions that number of attacking peers is known at each iteration. It is a toy example. Let us just ignore it for now. Let us look here. So the first two terms, again, they correspond to the complexity of parallel HGD in the ideal case when there are known, there are no Byzantine peers. And the second term, it actually has better dependence on epsilon. And it can be smaller than the third term, it has better dependence on epsilon and can be much smaller than this. when epsilon is small. So to sum up, we obtain the first scalable server-free method that in the presence of Byzantines achieve the same communication complexity as parallel SGD without Byzantines. So this is the first, to the best of our knowledge, this is the first algorithm with such properties. We also have complexity guarantees in convex and strongly convex cases, but let us keep it here because of the time limitations. And the ideas behind the proof are quite simple. We just need to derive upper bound for the bias when Byzantines attack. After that, we analyze just biased SGD such that the bias exists during the finite number of steps. And that's it. It just requires accurate derivations and we obtain these results. And also we conducted several experiments. Probably I will just briefly talk about them. Image classification and also retraining Albert on Wikitext. We had 7 Byzantines out of 16 peers. And these Byzantines, they used several widely used several benchmark attacks. For example, sign flipping, where they change the sign of the gradient, random direction when they send large vectors pointed at a common random direction, label flipping when they flip labels and compute gradients based on the cross entropy loss with flip labels, and delayed gradients attacks. And we obtained that our method has comparable performance with all reduced SGD, which has no attacks. And also our method recovers from the attacks quite fast. And we also, this here, we have results for Lisnet at CIFAR-10. And for Albert Reich at Wikitext, we have the following results. Note that it's enough to have just 100 or 200 steps in order to recover after the attack of Byzantines. And in conclusion, I would like to say that we also have analysis of BitArt clipped SGD for heavy tailed problems and also extra experiments and detailed versions of all the methods and proofs. So, okay, so this is what I wanted to present today. Now, if you have questions, please do not hesitate to ask me. I'll be happy to answer all of them.
Thank you, Edward, for your excellent talk. So please, if you have any question or comment, just raise your hand and then I'll try to unmute you. Or just post your question to our chat. Maybe I would start with one quick clarification question. If you just go one slide back to the experiment, what is tau in the experiment?
Oh, yeah, thanks. Tau, it's clipping level. So actually, in center clip, we used the fixed clipping level as in the paper where center clip was introduced. The authors suggested to use fixed clipping level, and actually it is enough to make just several steps of this iterative procedure. It's not needed to make too many steps, let's say 10 steps or even 5 steps works well.
And so and maybe in this graphs, like, do you also show like actually how many of the client are active and how many of them were like eliminated? Because I guess like at the end, you should have something like only 2 active clients, right? Because you had like 7 Byzantines, so and but only like good peer removes Byzantine. Is it actually the case?
Yeah. So actually, I don't remember exactly about this, but I think they were Byzantines were filtered out, I think. because they just started to attack at this. Yeah, they were filtered out. Yeah, because the attack was constructed in the following way. They started to attack at some step, and then they attack till they bend. As far as I remember, yeah.
So I guess there is a question from Constantine. Let me just unmute him. So please go ahead, Constantine.
Eduard, thanks for the nice talk. I think at the beginning of the talk or at the middle, you mentioned that SGD estimators should have bounded variance. So to use that work, I need to have estimators with bounded variance. And as I understand, it may be hard to achieve this in unbounded domain.
So thanks for the question. Actually, and uniformly bounded variance also it is classical assumption in stochastic optimization literature and used in many papers. It is restrictive. I agree that it is restrictive, but it does not imply that we have bounded domain, because the problem might be probably if we have bounded second moment, if you had bounded second moment, we would necessarily have bounded domain for, let's say, strongly convex problems, because strongly convex problem, it cannot have bounded gradient on the whole space, because bounded second moment imply boundedness of the norm of the gradient, but bounded variance does not imply this. So actually, we can consider, let's say, toyish example, like when the noise is additive, let's say we add some Gaussian noise to the gradient, and we will achieve this. Yeah. Okay. But I agree, absolutely agree that this assumption is quite restrictive, but actually in prior works people sometimes used even more restrictive assumptions. For example, sometimes people assume that the noise is bounded with probability one, so it is much more restrictive. But sometimes people assume that something else on the nature of attacks, like not arbitrary attacks. So yeah, investigating the making the proofs in more general setup, it's an interesting direction. Well, as far as I know, state of the art works, they use this assumption, or even stronger. Yeah.
So any other questions or comments? It seems there are no other comments. So thank you again, Eduard, for your excellent talk. And thanks everybody for tuning in. And I hope to see you all next week. So have a nice rest of the day. Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you a lot.
Thank you.
Bye.